Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our gathering here tonight at Bayside Church. I'd like to welcome those of you who are joining us via live stream as well. So great that you could be here with us. And we'd love to welcome any visitors, any new people you haven't been to our service. Welcome to Bayside Church. How about we be upstanding in the presence of God right now? You know, church, this week has been a big week. It's been a sad week. As you know, Andrew Chan and Myuran Sukumaran were both executed a few days ago. Pastor Rob, Pastor Christy, in fact, our whole Bayside family have been journeying with these young men for some years now. Many of you have prayed for them over these years. You've signed petitions. Some of you have been fortunate enough to meet two incredible young men. And as a tribute tonight to their lives, and also for the transforming work that God has done in both of them, during our time of worship, I would love to invite you forward, and we are going to light a candle in honor of both of these amazing individuals. As you come forward, the ushers will direct you on how to do that tonight. And we're going to spend some time in worship, worshiping our God. I will invite you to come forward right from the first song. There's many of us here tonight. Just to take a moment and honor and reflect on these men. We're going to start by singing a song tonight that declares the greatness of our God. Our God is great. Amen. He is good. He is majestic. He is awesome in power. He is mighty to save. We declare right now that our God is great. You are awesome in this place. We exalt you tonight, Lord God. We love you for who you are. We honor you and we adore you, Lord God. We ask that your presence come and fill this place and fill our hearts afresh with your love, with your grace, with your mercy and faithfulness towards us. We're going to sing with everything we've got tonight. And we're going to declare that you are indeed great. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great is our God. You are good and you are great. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great our God. We declare your greatness in this place. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great, yeah, is our God. And all will see how great. Oh, how great our God. Come on, let's sing the splendor of the King. Here we go. The splendor of the King, oh, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles that is for us. How great, oh how great, yeah, is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And don't we see how great. Sing tonight, our God. Oh, how great, yeah, is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, see how great, yeah, how great is our God. You are great, you are great, oh God. Come on, let's lift our praise to Him tonight. You are great, Lord God. We declare it in this place. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And all the earth will shout Your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are You, Lord. Yeah, yeah. All the earth will shout Your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. let's sing it out, church.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
Come on, we join with all the earth declaring our God is great.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Right now with songs of praise from our hearts. We praise you, Lord Jesus. You alone, Lord God, you alone, we lift our voice to you. We worship you. We thank you for who you are and how good you are to us. We praise you, Lord. We sing to you. We sing to you, Lord. So worthy, Lord. So worthy.
So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise.
Let's lift our voices in praise to Him tonight, church, can we? It's our, His breath in our lungs, amen. Just spend about 10 seconds just speaking something in praise to Jesus. We love You, Lord. We thank You for breath. We thank You for life. We thank You for Your grace. We thank You that You change and restore broken hearts and broken lives. We worship You here in this place tonight, Lord God, as a holy temple, a gathering of Your people who love You and can testify to the fact that Your grace and love has restored our lives. We thank You, Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Lord. Wonderful Savior. You know, this gathering tonight is not about two men. It's not about Andrew Chan. It's not about Myuran Sukumaran. Tonight is about Jesus. In fact, every time we gather together, He is always the focus of our gathering. He's the focus of our lives, everything that we are and everything that we do. But tonight and this weekend, I felt that it was very appropriate that as a church community and others, and we welcome anyone who's visiting with us tonight. You are most welcome, whoever you are. We've journeyed with these guys now for a number of years as a church community. As Jacob said before, many of you have been over to Bali. You've worked inside Kerobokan. You've met two reformed men. You've met many others over the years. I have met many, many people whose lives have been transformed just from meeting Andrew and Myuran. And, you know, we had hoped and we had prayed for a miracle. And God does not always answer our prayers like we expect. But as we talked about, you know, Andrew and myself and Myuran and myself earlier in the year, whether they live or die, they win. They're in a win-win. Amen. If they live here on this planet, they live for Jesus. And if their lives are taken, they go and be with Jesus. Amen. Amen. That's so good. And right now, if they were given the option, they'd stay where they are. I praise God that justice did prevail on Tuesday night and the early hours of Wednesday morning with the Filipino lady, Mary Jane Veloso. Many of you would have been aware of her story. We knew quite a lot to do with her personally, and most people were fully aware of her innocence and that she'd been set up by a people trafficking ring, and we are very, very grateful at the last moment that the person that had set her up, who I believe was a relative of hers, handed herself in to the Filipino authorities. And so Mary Jane was just saying goodbye to her two young sons when the authorities came up and told her the news. And so she's now in Jakarta, and we are hoping that she will be repatriated back home to the Philippines to be restored with her family. And it's one of the reasons, church, that we stand opposed to the death penalty, because an injustice was about to be done. The other eight who were executed were all guilty of trafficking drugs. And that's never been an argument. And I know, you know, people have said all sorts of things, and, you know, they're just drug traffickers and all of that kind of stuff. But, you know, all of us that stand here in this room, and those of you who are watching on live stream, we're all guilty of something, whether it's a lot or a little. Many of you know my story. Through my teens and my early 20s, I was very heavily involved in drugs. I grew my own marijuana. If I had been caught, I would have served a death sentence. And I was having a conversation with someone several months ago when they were saying to me that they believed that the guys should be executed. And I said, but they're rehabilitated. Why don't we allow them to serve out a life sentence so justice is still done, but let them continue the amazing work that they were doing at reforming? And they said, oh, no, well, we believe that they should be executed. And I said, would you shoot me? And they said, no. And I said, why wouldn't you shoot me? And they said, because you've changed. And I said, exactly. And they went, oh. But for whatever reason, the Indonesian authorities went ahead. The boys showed amazing courage right to the very end. They conducted themselves with great dignity. All eight of them had confessed faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. All eight. Reformed, changed, transformed. And they walked out onto the killing field singing songs of praise. Andrew and Myuran taught them the song 10,000 Reasons. And this became Mayu's favourite song. He and I had an incredible conversation in January. And I was over there for Andrew's 31st birthday and to preach for Gail and Wayan Dwiji, who were on long service leave. While I was there, Mayu's clemency appeal was knocked back. And obviously he was pretty gutted by that. And so the prison authorities allowed me to sit with him one morning. They gave us a quiet place and a couple of chairs and we were able to talk. And I asked him about his faith in God because he was raised as a Christian. His family are Christians. And he said to me, he said, a lot's happened. And he said, I feel pretty angry with God. And he said, I feel like that's a barrier between me and God. And I said, I just want to tell you, Mayu, it's not a barrier between you and God. God is big enough to handle your anger. And I would encourage you to start expressing your anger to God and also to start reading the Psalms, because the Psalms are a collection of songs, poems that are full of human experience and questions and some angry statements as well. You hear David particularly, where are you, God? Why are you allowing this to happen? Why are my enemies triumphing over me? Why do the wicked prosper and the righteous are poor? All of these great questions, honest questions. And I said to him, start expressing honesty to God and I encourage you to develop a relationship with him. Christy messaged me earlier in the week and she said, because I said, how are you going and how are things with Andrew and Mayu? And she said, I was talking to Myuran today and he said that conversation that you and he had back in January was the catalyst for starting him to walk closer to God again, because he realized that anger was not a barrier between him and his God. And he's given his life to Jesus. Amen. And so 10,000 Reasons became his favorite song. His sister put something on Facebook the other night and said, please everyone sing this song for Mayu. And they were all singing it, all eight of them standing there. And I won't go into detail, but, you know, while they were about to be executed, they were all singing. Andrew was heard saying, come on, sing louder, in his typical form. And they were singing that song as their lives were taken. And they were absent from the body, but they're now present with the Lord. Amen. And so we're going to sing this song. This is an anthem of praise. And it's a beautiful song because it expresses not just now, but it expresses eternity. Amen. 10,000 Reasons. Amen.
Let's sing loud and proud.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. We worship your holy name, yeah, yeah.
Sing, the sun comes up.
The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Come on, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. worship His holy name. Yeah. A sin like this.
They're singing that in heaven right now, I reckon. 10,000 years and then forevermore. One day we're going to join that company. It's going to be amazing, isn't it? Eternity in the presence of God. But it's hard for those who were left behind. Christy flew back in to Sydney this morning with the Sukumaran family. Ken and Helen Chan came in yesterday. The bodies of the boys came in on the flight overnight, and they're back in Sydney now. And funeral preparations will, of course, now have to be made. Another reason I hate the death penalty is it punishes the innocent. It punishes the families, punishes the friends. And so right now, as a community of believers, can we just lift the families, the Chan, Sukumaran families, the families of the other six as well. Let's lift up the family and the friends together, amen. Let's just lift our voices in prayer. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Precious family members, we lift up Ken and Helen Chan to you, Lord God. Michael, the extended family, all of the Sukumaran family, Lord God. Thank you for these precious people. Thank you for Ken and Helen who came to faith through Andrew, their son. Lord, your word tells us that you are the God of all comfort. And that's our prayer right now, Lord God, for these precious people, for Andrew's family, for Mayu's family, for the families of the other six who were executed in the early hours of Wednesday morning, for all of the close friends, for those who have been impacted, not just by their deaths, Lord God, but by their lives as well. Thank you for the hundreds, possibly thousands of people who are now out of prison and living reformed lives because of your grace expressed through these men. You are the God of all comfort. Comfort them. Comfort all of us in this time of loss. I pray over the next few days, weeks, months, as the grief process is worked through, help people with their anger, with their questions, with their grief. Lord, I pray through all of this that the breath of your Spirit, your love, your grace, your presence, your mercy would be breathed into every person's life. Lord, you are the one who works all things together for good for those who love you. Work good through this, Lord, I pray. May precious people come into relationship with you. May the legacy of these men live on. In Jesus' name we pray. All God's people said, amen. Well, God bless you. Just before you take your seats, turn to a few people. Give them a really warm welcome tonight to Bayside Church.
Well, what an amazing time of worship and a great tribute as well. I'd like to formally just welcome you to Bayside tonight. You've picked a great night to come along and worship with us. And I just take a moment to welcome those who are visiting with us as well, has been done. But we'd just like to formally acknowledge you. We have a welcome pack that we'd love to give you. It's got some information about Bayside Church, the other things that we do here and how you can better get connected as well. And it's actually got also, very especially, a coffee card in there for three coffees or hot chocolates at our baristas out the front. And so we'd just like to give you one of those right now, but just the ushers can identify you. You want to raise your hand and they'll get one of those packs to you. Any first-time visitors? There's going to be a few. Yeah, down the back here, let's give them a welcome. Thank you. Down the front here as well. Just keep your hands up for the ushers. They'll get those packs to you. As said, you've chosen a great night to check us out. We're in the middle of our Simply Irresistible series, and Pastor Rob's going to be preaching on the pure life in just a moment, which is going to be excellent. You'll notice inside those packs is also a two-sided form and a pen. If you'd put those together and then pop the form in the offering bucket, we'd appreciate that as well. Those watching online, we know that you are going to be blessed and enjoy the service wherever you are around Australia or around the world. So welcome and thank you for joining us for our service. You may have noticed on your way in that we have stalls up the back. Next weekend is Mother's Day and you need to remember your mums, okay? And if you haven't got a present already or if you'd like to get one, please check out the crafts we have there. All proceeds are going towards North Rise University. Nepal's coming later on. North Rise University, and which we've heard about over the last few weeks, doing an amazing work there, just educating the people of Zambia. Next weekend, also for the mums, we have the Melbourne Gospel Choir. They're always a joy to have here. Yeah, a few cheers that are going up. They always give us a great show. It's great to bring your mums along. We have a fantastic morning tea to share with them at the end. So please do get your mums along for that and enjoy the service with them as well. Before we continue, I just want to pause and I want to take a moment just to honour Pastor Rob and Christy. We've just been really impressed as a staff, I know as a congregation, of the journey you've done over the last 7 years with Andrew and Mayu and their families and for everyone else, just how well you've been advocating for them, the grace, the mercy and the justice that you've been showing. We just have really appreciated all that you've done, especially the last few weeks. I know Christy on the ground there, I can only imagine what that would have been like. But you guys have shown such integrity, such consistency throughout the whole thing and the way you've conducted yourselves. I know the radio interviews at all hours of the day and TV, what they've done that we haven't seen behind the scenes has been absolutely amazing. And it's just a great example you've set for us all. And we just want to thank you. We love being a part of this church and being on the team. And so I think how we put our hands together, Pastor Rob and Christy, done so well. Fantastic. Very well deserved. Thanks, guys. I don't know how I even got through there. I wouldn't have been able to get up and pray. So, very good. We're going to continue worshiping God now as we come around our offering. So if you would like to prepare that, that'd be great. If you need credit cards, slips, you want to raise your hand, the ushers get one of those to you. And those of you who are on devices, you can use push pay. And also, if you're following us online, there's also online giving options that you can do wherever you are. I just want to continue with a theme, actually, that we've been has been coming out through worship and through what Jacob was saying and Pastor Rob was saying, and just share with you Isaiah 55 and verses 8 and verse 9. It says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." I know with everything that's been going on the last few weeks, sometimes you sit there and go, what is happening? And we start to question, and that's okay. But to remember that God is good all the time. All the time, He is good. That we are not God, we don't know everything, but we still trust Him. And I can't explain it when it comes to finances and as we give. You know, people will always question us, you know, why do we do that? And I just say, because I'm faithful, because God is good. I can't explain how it works out, how the maths adds up, but God always provides as we have the generous hearts and we give back. So that's what we're just doing right now. It's honouring God, saying your ways are higher than our ways and we're trusting in you. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you that you are good all the time, that you provide for our every need. Help us to keep focused on you, to not get caught up in the things of the world, but to trust in you and all we do. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Well, ushers, if you'd receive the offering, we'd really appreciate that. And for everyone else, if you turn your attention to the screens, we have this week's Bayside News.
You guys, I'm so excited about Hope for a Home.
I know, right? Wait, what's Hope for a Home?
It's only going to be the hashtag best fundraiser yet. And I know I say a lot of hashtags, this one I really mean.
Wow, that does sound exciting. What are we raising funds for?
We are raising funds to support the Young Adult Discipleship Homes, or D Houses, in Bali.
I believe we have some vision of some of the awesome young people that live in the D Houses.
Look at those champions. They are so thankful for the supportive environment these homes provide.
What a worthy cause, Hudson, but what are we going to be doing on the night?
We are going to put the fun in fundraiser. There's going to be live music, amazing raffle prizes, hot drinks, and Spanish donuts. You also get to hear more about the D Houses and have an opportunity to sign up for the next proposed missions trip to Bali, where you can meet these awesome guys.
That honestly sounds like it's going to be a great night.
Hashtag best fundraiser yet.
So if you're a young adult, make sure you secure your ticket today and book online.
Book online for $20 or $25 at the door. See you there, and thank you for giving Hope for a Home.
First Fruits is the weekend in which the leadership of Bayside Church encourages everyone to give 1 week's income to the Lord's work. It is a wonderful act of consecration where we give our best to God. First Fruits enables us to say yes to the projects as they arise and continue the good work that the Lord has begun.
First Fruits has come to mean to me probably two things: being able to be a blessing to Bayside Church in the blessings that I've received throughout the year, and also receiving a blessing. I can be blessed by God to be a blessing to Bayside Church.
Coming up this week on The Exchange, makings of a good friend.
You know, there's kind of cultural norms now around being seen and acknowledged by liking something.
So tell me, what makes a true friend?
Being able to trust them, I think, and loyalty.
If you like something that sort of reflects your identity and then other people like it, then you get a sense that you're affirmed in, you know, the person you're becoming. Mm.
Head to theexchangetv.com.au for television airtimes and to watch episodes online.
Celebrate the love, light and hope mums bring this Mother's Day. Mums will love the Melbourne Gospel Choir as they perform. There will also be a scrumptious morning tea after the gathering. This is going to be an amazing morning, so why not invite someone special along to enjoy it with you?
Professor Silly, did you know that the New Testament is not presented in the order which the original books were written?
What? That's so confusing.
It's okay, Professor Silly. To overcome this problem, Bayside Church has a chronological reading plan using the Book of Acts as a framework.
Well, that is a relief.
It sure is. So join us this week as we read the Book of Galatians. Hop onto the Bayside Church website to hear Pastor Rob share some insights on these passages of Scripture.
And don't forget to bring your glasses.
Thanks for watching Bayside News. If you'd like more information, get online, pick up Bayside Life, or head to the iConnect desk. Church has changed. Check it out.
It sure has, hasn't it? For the better as well. Wonderful. Well, I loved seeing that on Bayside News, and I love seeing what our young adults are doing. You've probably realised from that as a church, we are not boycotting Bali. And I have seen that. And look, I understand people's anger and frustration at what has taken place. Can I encourage you to, if you are angry and frustrated, nothing wrong with being angry. The Bible says, be angry, but do not sin. So you can be angry about stuff. I'm angry with the injustice of life. What about you? And we as a church community, we do what we can do to rectify the injustices of life. And we do that in a number of ways. One of the ways we do that is working with a church, C3 Church, in Bali, and we're working, our young adults are working with the young adults there. You know, as Forbo said before, we've got different handicrafts for sale. All of the proceeds from those handicrafts go toward correcting injustice in the world. And that's about, we cannot rectify every problem in the world. I've had people say that to me, even, you know, working with Andrew and Mayu. Well, you know, what about other people? I said, well, we can't do everything. But as a community of believers, we can do something. And sometimes we look at problems and we say, wow, that's so big, I can't rectify that problem. And then we do nothing. But whereas a church, we say, that problem's so big, I can't do much, but the little I can do, I will do. And so can I encourage each and every one of you, learn in life to channel your anger, your frustration at injustice in the world, channel it in a positive way. Boycotting Bali would only hurt the people of Bali who are already poor. And we're not about to do that. And so we will continue to work in that way. I want to thank you as well. I was very humbled and quite embarrassed at the way you all stood and clapped. I got to say, it's like having people sing happy birthday to you. It's great for everybody else, but it's really awkward for the person, you know? You know what I'm saying? So I'm sitting there going, oh, can it stop now? And eventually you did, and I thank you for that. But I also thank you for the very kind words spoken. It was so nice. I want to thank you, actually, because I know that when Christy and I first came back from Bali, and Gail and Wayan Dawiji from C3 Church in Bali had taken us into Karobakan prison. Understand, we weren't looking for something else to do. And we were there actually because we'd just been through a few months that were incredibly stressful, and we were both tired, and we just decided to have a few days of rest and relaxation. And part of the rest was catching up with old friends and who said, we're doing this work in Karobakan, would you like to come and meet Andrew Chad? And we said, yes. And that's where it started. And we met him, and we were so impressed with him and Myuran, and with Matthew Norman too, who's got a life sentence. He's now 27, and he's a Christian too. And there's another guy, I forget his Asian name, but everyone calls him Jimmy. And he is he's now doing jewelry. He's teaching people jewelry inside Karobakan. He's got a Facebook page. It's called Mule Jewels. I kid you not. You can find it on Facebook. So they're the four who completely reformed out of the nine. And it was meeting these guys and just being blown away at the grace of God in their lives that has transformed men who trafficked drugs into men who wanted to make a difference to the lives of other people. Matthew Norman teaches English inside Karobakan prison. He's helping Indonesians learn English so that when they get out, they can actually, you know, get a better job. And that's what these guys have been doing, and that's what's struck us. But I know that when we came back and we made that announcement, some people thought, oh, that sounds wonderful. Other people were sitting back going, what? And you know, we've had some really, you know, good conversations over the last few years, just trying to help people understand why we're doing what we're doing. We weren't looking for it, but it was a God thing. And we had to be obedient to the Spirit of God. And so I just want to thank you. It's been a gutsy move, I know, for us as a church community. And I want to thank each and every one of you for coming on that journey with us. And God is bringing and will bring some amazing things out of what has taken place. Amen. Well, we're going to turn to God's Word right now. Let's go together to the book of Titus. Yeah. Christy sends her love, by the way, and she is looking forward to being home, as I'm sure you can imagine. Message notes are online. Those of you who are watching live stream, you can download the message notes as well just by clicking on the weekly link button. We also have message notes on the YouVersion Bible app too. As Forbo mentioned just a few minutes ago, we're in a series which is called Simply Irresistible. For those of you who remember Robert Palmer, you'll remember his song. No, I'm not about to burst into that. Lyrics from memory. Yes, someone's very happy that I'm not going to sing that. I think it was enough me singing a country song a couple of weekends ago. But Simply Irresistible, and looking at some of the qualities of the Christian life that are attractive to people. That's one of the things, and we're going to read from the book of Titus in a moment. One of the things I love about Bayside Church is that people who are not necessarily Christian, they don't necessarily, wouldn't even think of normally darkening the door of a church building or a church service, They find something about Bayside attractive. I've had some incredible conversations over the last few weeks, especially with people in the media who are not religious and not Christian. I had an SMS the other night from a lady who produces a very well-known program on Australian television, and she said to me, she said, this is Tuesday night, the night of the execution. She said, I'm not religious, but right now I'm praying for a miracle. And so there's been many conversations like that with different people who I believe that the gospel, that Christianity should be attractive. Amen. It should be, if we're living right, simply irresistible. And so last week we looked at the generous life and I taught you a little saying. Does anyone remember what that saying was? It started with generosity. That's all repeated after me. Generosity has nothing to do with how much I have. Amen. Titus chapter 1 and verse 5. And Titus is a little letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to Titus, this guy. This is one of the pastoral epistles. It's written to a pastor. At this particular time, Titus was the leader of all the churches on the island of Crete. And he writes there in Titus 1 and verse 5, the reason I left you in Crete was that you might put in order what was left unfinished and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. And so this island, one of the largest islands in the Mediterranean, it's near Greece, just north of Libya. And it was a very prosperous island back in the first century. In fact, it was known as the Island of 100 Cities. And the Apostle Paul had spent time on this island going around and pioneering churches. And Paul only spent a very short time. He would normally spend 3 or 4 months in each place. He moved very, very fast. He would move in, find a few people that were interested in the gospel, get a small group of people together, and then he'd leave. And he'd go to the next place. And then sometime later, he'd go back and see if anyone was still there. It's a very interesting strategy. And Titus was part of his ministry team, and he said to Titus, I'm moving on, but I'm going to leave you in Crete because I want you, as he says there, he says, I want you to put in order what was left unfinished. And then he said, I want you to appoint elders or pastors. This word elder is not to be confused. It's used interchangeably in the New Testament. You'll find it used in Acts 20 for elders, pastors, shepherds, bishops, overseers. What he's talking here about is appointing leadership teams in every church. And so it's likely that there was a church in all of the 100 towns or cities in Crete, and Titus was overseeing all of those. He was the first multi-site pastor. This was the campus churches of Crete, if you like, if you want to use modern day terminology. Now, with that background in mind, I want you to go over to chapter 2 and verse 11. Titus chapter 2, verse 11, he says, for the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to good people. Sorry, did I say something wrong? Ah, the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. Wow. I had a wonderful conversation a while ago with someone who, and they said, I'm really concerned about people that teach about extreme grace. I said, really? Why? I said, grace, by the very nature of it, is extreme. It's like an oxymoron putting those two. Grace is extreme. That's what grace is. It's the same as, you know, as I said before, I've had a number of interesting conversations over the last few years with people who didn't understand or, you know, don't understand why we were advocating for these two men who trafficked drugs or at least tried to traffic drugs out of Indonesia into Australia. And I had one guy come to me one day and he said, but they don't deserve mercy. I said, I can't agree with you more. And he looked at me like a rabbit stuck in headlights. Don't deserve mercy. I said, I couldn't agree with you more. He said, what do you mean? I said, no one deserves mercy. That's why it's mercy. Mercy is something that we don't deserve. And so is grace. And both are extreme. and the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. In other words, you will never lock eyes with someone who is outside the realms of the grace of God, no matter who they are or what they've done. And we don't have to like what they did, and we don't have to agree with what they did. I certainly don't agree with what the Bali Nine tried to do, or any other drug trafficker or any other criminal. This is not about being soft on justice. I wish all drug traffickers were caught. I wish all drugs were limited from doing the damage that they have done and are doing to countless individuals and families around Australia and Indonesia and other nations. But I want to say, in the midst of all of that, there is not one person who finds themselves outside the realms of the grace of God when they turn to Him looking for it. Let's read on. Chapter 2 and verse 12. It teaches us. Now, the it there is God's grace. So God's grace teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright and godly lives in this present age. While we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Saviour, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. And then Paul says to Titus, he said, these things then, these are the things you should teach as a pastor. That's why I'm teaching them, because I'm a pastor too. He says, encourage and rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you. Now, if you look at the context of the verses that we have just read, in the first 10 verses you can read in your own time. But what Paul is teaching here is teaching about living our lives in such a way. Look at verse 10 with me. Living our lives in such a way so that in every way they will make the teaching about God our Savior attractive. That word attractive there means appealing. It means simply irresistible. In other words, people of God, Christian men and women, the way we live our lives is to be attractive to those who don't know Jesus yet. Isn't it an absolute tragedy that so often the church and Christians are known for all that we are against, and we moralize? I've seen some of the most unkind comments on Facebook, even this week. I had to say to one guy, I said, could you please stop writing this stuff now? I am grieving for two men who have become great friends. Could you just give me a little while? There's a Christian guy. And then he wouldn't. He just kept going. So, how unattractive is that? How unattractive when the church becomes the moral police, that we're known for everything that we're against, rather than living our lives in such a way as the Apostle Paul is saying here, so that in every way they may make the teaching about God, our Saviour, attractive, appealing, simply irresistible. And we do that by saying no and saying yes. In the first part of verse 12, saying no. God's grace teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions. The grace of God is extreme, but it's not cheap. The grace of God is not an excuse to live an impure, immoral life. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions. Let me define those two things for you. Ungodliness is believing in God while adopting a lifestyle which seems to contradict your belief. We commonly refer to it as hypocrisy. And that's one of the things that the broader community find incredibly unattractive about church and Christianity, when we preach a message but then don't live up to it. We preach ourselves at this high standard rather than talking about ourselves as works in progress who are still imperfect and haven't got it all together. We come across as holier than thou, and when people find out we're not holier than thou, they go, bunch of hypocrites. Wouldn't want to join that mob. Bunch of hypocrites. I always say, oh, we can handle another one. But that's ungodliness. Ungodliness says, I know this is wrong, but God will forgive me, and goes ahead and does it anyway. Worldly passions are the tendency to conform to the world. It's following the crowd. Both of those things cheapen grace and make Christianity unattractive to the people around us. Cheap grace was alive and well in the first century church. Paul addressed it in Romans chapter 6, 1. He says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? He says, by no means. Or in the King James, God forbid. Because there were people in the first century church who were saying, well, God forgives us when we sin, so let's sin more to enable God to be more gracious. And Paul's going, no! Galatians chapter 5 and verse 13, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh, rather serve one another humbly in love. So he says, channel your energy, not in a sinful way, but in a serving way. Author Paul Ellis puts it this way, grace is no more a license to sin than electricity is a license to electrocute yourself. Beautifully put. And so God's grace teaches us to say no, but it also teaches us about saying yes. If you look at the second part of verse 12, it says God's grace teaches us to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. That is, our lives will be decent, honest, respectable, and consistent with our belief in God. A life like that is simply irresistible. He says, exercise self-control or self-restraint. This is the opposite of excess. Someone bought me 3 bars of chocolate the other day. It was very nice. Thank you, Jacob. Orange chocolate. He asked Gigi, he said, what's your dad's favourite chocolate? And he said, orange chocolate. Orange chocolate is yummy. I said, oh, now please don't all buy me a bar of orange chocolate for next week. And a few weeks later, you see, Pastor Rob's larger than he used to be. The other night I was sitting at home and I felt like a bit of chocolate. And so I got one of the bars and I opened it up and I took 2 squares. I think there's a bit of pride coming out right now. And I ate the 2 squares. And I thought, you know, this is a wonderful sermon illustration. I can demonstrate to the congregation my great self-control. And then I ate the rest of the bar. So, it's my confession session. Anyone in good company? Am I in good company? Okay, yeah. I thought I had to do that, you know, because Christy, when she opens a bar of chocolate, the whole thing has to go in one night. And the kids are the same, so... So there goes my sermon illustration. But self-control is to exercise restraint. Self-control is doing what I need to do when I don't feel like doing it, and it is not doing what I should not do when I do feel like doing it, if you follow me. Let me give you some examples of self-control. Example one, if someone is rude to me or says something offensive, my flesh wants to respond by telling them where to go. Self-control is required to display love and kindness. Let me tell you how much self-control I do exercise when I'm on Facebook, trying to correct some of the obnoxious people who interact with me on there. Example two, the number of times I've written something and then rewritten it, and then rewritten it, and then deleted it. Example two, if I am feeling flat or things aren't going right in my life, self-control is required for me to display joy. Example three, when I'm struggling financially and the economy is bad, self-control is required to have peace. And my final example, example number four, when I'm running late and there's a person in front of me who can't read the massive sign that says, keep left unless overtaking. Self-control is needed. To be patient. Titus chapter 2 then gives us 2 reasons that empower us to live this life of saying no to the wrong things and saying yes to the right. Reason number 1 is looking forward. Reason number 2 is looking back. If you look at verse 13, looking forward, he says, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So we're looking forward to the second coming. Why do I say no to doing the wrong thing and yes to doing the right thing? Because Jesus is coming back. That's why. And number 2, looking back, verse 14. Jesus, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. Isn't that a beautiful statement? Jesus gave himself to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. That's the work that we've seen in our lives personally. That's my testimony. That's my story. That's what I saw in Andrew Chan and Myuran Sukumaran. I saw two men who Jesus gave his life for. He redeemed them, emancipated them, set them free. Andrew said to me one day years ago, he said, I might be behind bars, but I have never been so free in all my life. Freedom, right there. Why? Free in Christ. They were set free from all wickedness. They did not die as drug traffickers. That's what they were. That is not what they became. They were purified. God is looking at redeeming people and purifying them for his very own and putting that quality in our life, eager to do what is good. Those men spent every day doing what was good. Andrew would get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and the first thing he would do is go and unlock the chapel so people could come in and pray. He spent his days discipling people, doing Bible studies, counseling, encouraging. He taught hospitality, first aid, all of these different things that equipped people. I met a man earlier this year while I was visiting Andrew in prison, and Andrew introduced me to this guy. His name escapes me, but he was a multiple offender. He was in and out of Korobakan several times all of his life. He'd met Andrew and he'd become a Christian, and then he was released from jail, and now he is completely reformed. This man is now married. He and his wife are expecting their first child, and he's holding down a full-time job as a security guard. That's just one of hundreds of stories as a result. Something happens when Jesus comes into your life. You become a person that is eager to do what is good. Jesus did us good, and then he puts goodness in us. Jesus redeemed or emancipated us, just like he did for John Newton, the author of the much-loved hymn Amazing Grace. John Newton was both a slave and then a slave trader. He trafficked people, and yet he came to know the freedom and grace that only Jesus can give, for the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. And so in the still of the night air of Nusa Kambangan Island, condemned prisoners sang Amazing Grace just after midnight. Pastor Karina De Vega, who was there, one of the spiritual advisors, she said, and I quote, "It was breathtaking. This was the first time I witnessed someone so excited to meet their God." Pastor Lee Carlson, who's a very dear friend from Bali, he pastors a great church in Bali, and he posted this on Facebook the other day. While Andrew was in the holding cell prior to execution, he shared the gospel with the only Indonesian among the nine, or then the eight, to be executed. The man was a Muslim who subsequently had a vision of the Lord Jesus, which is quite common among Muslims who give their life to Christ. Andrew also taught everyone a song, which was 10,000 Reasons. And as they were being led to the firing squad, they were all singing. Andrew was heard encouraging them to sing louder. There were about 15 of the guards who were visibly upset. Andrew went and embraced each of the 15 guards and said he forgave them for what they were about to do. Apparently, they were still singing when the shots rang out and silenced them. While some continue to focus on what Andrew Chan and Myuran Sukumaran did just over a decade ago, we will choose, because of the amazing grace of God, to focus on what they became. John Newton, the slave who became a slave trader, a people trafficker, became a pastor. So did Andrew Chan. Myuran Sukumaran became a painter, an amazing artist. They both leave a remarkable legacy of the people they've reformed and led to faith in Jesus. I find it more than a coincidence that 8 forgiven traffickers of drugs would sing a hymn written by 1 forgiven trafficker of people as they were led out to the killing fields. The song Amazing Grace is the best known and best loved hymn of all time. I had a tweet this week, said this, Rob Buckingham, I am an atheist, but that hymn has always brought me undone, all the more so now. It will always speak to me of bravery. I invite you, as my church family, would you all stand and let's declare the words of this amazing song.
Ransomed me, and like a flood.
Thank you for your amazing grace, Lord. We all stand here recipients of His amazing grace. Amen. Maybe there are some of you standing here tonight and you haven't accepted the amazing grace of God. And it's simply this, that when God gives us what we don't deserve, mercy's the opposite. God is merciful when He doesn't give us what we do deserve. Punishment for the things that we've done wrong in life, that's mercy. Grace is when God adds to that. And He said, now I'm going to give you what you don't deserve. And He pours forgiveness and love and all of the other beautiful qualities of His Spirit into our lives and makes a difference. I want each and every one of you, while you're standing, just to bow your heads. And if I can just have the house lights up just a little bit. Just every head bowed and every eye closed. And I want to give opportunity right now to anyone here. You say, I want to receive the amazing grace of God. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to call you out the front. I'm going to just allow you to do that in the privacy of your own time. And then after this gathering, you'll get to meet with someone who will give you a Bible and just give you a little bit of information. But if that's you, if you want to receive the amazing grace of God, you might not understand all that that even entails right now, but there's something on the inside of you that says, I want to know about this God, not just about, but I want to know Him. If that's you, where you are, while no one's looking around, I want you just to raise your hand nice and high so I can see it. God bless you. I see your hand there. Anyone else like to join this lady? Lift your hand up. Gentlemen, ladies, yes, someone else with their hand raised. God bless you, sir. That's wonderful. We're going to pray a prayer together as a congregation. I'm just going to ask one more time. If that's you and you want to be included in this prayer, just raise your hand up nice and high. God bless you there, mate. I see your hand. It's wonderful. Love it when kids respond too. It's the best. Maybe you made that decision a long time ago, but you've kind of drifted away and tonight you say, I want to come back to Jesus. If that's you, you raise your hand up high. Anyone like that? Okay, I'm going to pray a prayer. I want you to repeat, each and every one of you, I want you to repeat this prayer after me. And the three people that you raised your hands, I want you to make this your prayer. Pray it from your heart. God will hear your prayer and He will answer it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank You for the gift of grace through Your Son, Jesus. I believe that on the cross, Jesus Christ paid the price for me. He rose again so that I might be fully pardoned. I invite You into my life right now. Lord Jesus, come in, forgive me, and wash me clean. From this night on, I will live for You. Amen. Let's give Jesus a standing ovation, shall we? Thank You, Lord. So good. That is so good. Just take your seats for a moment, if you would, please. We've got a couple of our lovely leaders at the back, Nolene and Bev. And those of you, the three of you that prayed that prayer for the first time, just meet with Bev and Nolene. You can either walk down now if you want to, or you can wait till the end of the meeting and just go and meet with them. As I said before, they'd like to give you a Bible and a little info pack that will give you a little bit of detail about what you've just done and where to go next. Through the week, we've been, of course, seeing a lot, hearing a lot about the devastation that's taken place in Nepal. As a church community, as I've said throughout the evening, you know, we're not a one-issue church. This is not all about, you know, what God has been doing in Karobakan prison. We work in a lot of places. We do a lot around our own local community with the poor, with the disadvantaged. We work overseas in places like Bali and places like Africa and other places, Thailand. And whenever there is a major disaster, we can't respond to everything. But whenever there is something major that happens, I like to give us opportunity as a church community to do something. A number of people from the church have contacted me through the week and just said, are we going to be doing something to help the people of Nepal? And I think we should, don't you? I was preparing something last Sunday afternoon just at home doing some work, and I was sitting on the couch with my laptop, and my mobile phone went off, and it was Tim Costello. And Tim said to me, "Look, I'm just about to leave the country, but I just wanted to let you know that I'm praying for you and Christy and Bayside, and praying for the boys in Indonesia." And that meant a lot to me. It really did, that he took that time. And he said, "I'm just in the car at the moment. I'm driving to the airport. I'm about to fly to Kathmandu." He said, "We have 200 World Vision staff in Nepal, and most of them have lost their homes. And of course, we've seen on the news the absolute devastation. They're expecting well over 10,000 people to have died in the earthquake. Many of the villages are still cut off, and so the full extent is still not known. But I love World Vision. They're the real deal. I know Tim well, and I know that anything that we give to World Vision gets through to make a difference to the people. They're already on the ground there. They're organising with their other agencies in other countries to bring aid in, water sterilising and blankets and food and all the various things that they're going to need. And of course, they, along with other aid agencies and different governments around the world, will help Nepal rebuild. And so right now, we're going to receive an offering specifically for World Vision's work in Nepal. If you would like to participate in this, please feel free to. If you're unable or unwilling, that's fine. No pressure at all. But if you want to respond, feel free. If you want a credit card slip, just raise your hand. The ushers will bring those around to you. And while you're getting that ready, Tim sent a brief clip through from Nepal, and this is just updating some of the situation and World Vision's work there. So just have a look at the screen while you're getting your offering ready too. Thanks.
Thank you so much for your support for Nepalese. 5,000 have died, it might go up to 10,000, and every life is sacred. I'm here at the World Vision headquarters in Kathmandu. You can see that the rubble is around me, and there's relief operations going on behind me. Many of our 200 staff, their houses are gone. They're sleeping out under tarpaulins, and then turning up and distributing food, clean water, tarpaulins, and medical kits. So this is the big one, with so many people dead and in the region still missing. To be here and to be a Christian organisation helping is a rare privilege and a statement of the gospel. It's mainly a Hindu country with then Buddhists and a small Christian community. So when they say, "But you're a Christian organisation," I'm very proud to say, well, Jesus didn't say just love Christians. We love everyone. And with your prayers, with your support for really the Nepalese, the gentlest people, to actually stand with them in this moment of terrible, terrible tragedy is such a privilege. Thank you for your support.
Okay, that's wonderful. So it just gives you a quick update and we'll keep you updated as I get more information to hand. Let's all stand together, shall we? Ushers, if you'd like to receive this offering. And we're just going to finish our gathering tonight by declaring one more time, how great is our God. Amen.
And how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great, how great is our God. Sing it again. How great, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Come on, one more time. How great is our God. Let's sing it out. Oh, how great, yeah, is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. How great is our God. Amen. Well, that does conclude our gathering tonight. So great that you could be here with us. Have you had a great time in God's presence? Thank you, Pastor Rob, for a very powerful word tonight as well. Our visitor's lounge is now open. Please remember to pick up your children in the next 15 minutes. And why don't you check out our Mother's Day stalls as well. Pick up something for Mum next weekend. God bless. We will see you next weekend.